Good afternoon to all. Am I audible,
Good
sir?
Afternoon. Yes.
Yeah, you are.
Good afternoon to one and all present. I thank everyone for this opportunity. I would like to discuss my thesis study with you all. In this study, we are going to compare the anxiety among elderly and adult hemodialysis patients. Anxiety is nothing but a fear. In this study, anxiety is discussed in the patients undergoing hemodialysis. Anxiety in patients is interlinked with social support, depression, pain, social determinants, and environmental factors, where these factors affect the patient's quality of life. Hemodialysis patients experience chronic anxiety in every session. I have reviewed some papers for the study. First, one of the paper entitled as Anxiety in Patients Treated with Hemodialysis, done by Scott D. Cohen in the year of 2016. This paper summarizes, in this review, we present three clinical signals, which are anxiety, depression, and pain, highlighting the impact of anxiety disorders in patients with ESRD treated with HD. Next, the paper is Depression and Anxiety Among Patients Undergoing Dialysis. It is an observational study done by Santosh Pai, BH, in the year of 2020. Anxiety and depression are most prevalent psychological disorder in patients, which result in poor health outcome in ESRD patients. This may reduce the quality of survival of the patient. The aim of the study is to compare the anxiety level among both elderly and adult hemodialysis patients. The objective is to basic demographic data and evaluate the anxiety level among HD patients. The methodology of our study is, the questionnaire used in this study is Beck's Anxiety Inventory. This consists of 21 questions with 4 weights, which concludes the data. Here, we took population of 41 hemodialysis patients. Data was analyzed with SPS S version 25. Here comes the results, which includes 11 demographic data, such as age, gender, educational status, occupation, duration of dialysis, frequency of dialysis, vascular access failure, etc. of the patient. In this result, age and the duration of dialysis are specified here. Results. These are the variables which correlated in anxiety level and demographic data of the patient, such as age, duration on dialysis, vascular access, dialysis-related complications. Here comes the classification. Patient population is classified into 4 groups. Group 1, age less than 50 years, duration less than 3 years. Group 2, age more than 50 years, and duration of dialysis less than 3 years. Group 3, age less than 50 years and more than 3 years of the duration of dialysis. Group 4, age more than 50 years and duration of dialysis also more than 3 years. This graph represents the association of the duration of dialysis and age with the anxiety, the dialysis patient. Among the 4 groups, that is more than 50 years of age and more than 3 years of dialysis, have mild anxiety, whereas group 2 and 3 have mild anxiety, whereas group 1, which is less than 50 years and less than 3 years of duration of dialysis, have more severe anxiety. This concludes the patients with lower age and lesser duration of dialysis have severe anxiety when compared with the other groups. Here we classified less than 50 years patients are adults, more than 50 years patients are elderly patients. Here I have discussed several papers in the study with the variables such as age, vascular access, duration of dialysis, dialysis related complications. Age is discussed with a paper done by Dumitrescu et al. In the year of 2014 with a p-value of 0.505. Next comes vascular access, done by Daniel Cristina Sampio D. Brito et al. In the year of 2019, the p-value of 0.009, which is significant. Duration of dialysis means how many years the patient is undergoing the dialysis therapy. It's discussed with Robert W. Cotton et al. In the year of 2019 with a value of 0.001, which is highly significant with our study. The study concludes, this study provides extensive information on the relationship between anxiety and socio-demographic features of the patient with CKD undergoing prolonged hemodialysis, age, vascular access, duration of dialysis, and dialysis-related complication are the associated factors in the study population. Thereby, anxiety is more prevalent in younger adults with a shorter duration of dialysis. Thank you.
Judges are requested to ask some questions related to this topic.
Shall I start asking questions?
Yes, sir.
Thank you so much for a nice study and a nice presentation, as you seem to have a good insight about your research paper. May I ask you some? Apart from whatever you have discussed as the potential determinants of anxiety and depression, there are some other factors as well. For instance, presence of multiple morbidities. What kind of has is
I'm not audible, sir.
Hello? I'm audible.
Your internet is not stable, sir. Your voice is not clear.
Am I audible now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, fine. See, what kind of dialysis is it? Is it funded by the government, or the patient is covered by insurance, our patient is spending? That is number one. Number two, presence or absence of multiple comorbidities. Two, and third thing is that the family and social support of the family. And fourth one, nutritional status. These are also additional factors we have studied in our this thing. And then gender-wise, I don't know whether I failed to observe whether you have studied gender-wise the prevalence of anxiety. Nice presentation.
Thank you.
Sudhir, you have got any questions?
Yeah. Have you looked at the male versus female anxiety? Is there any difference? Sir. Is there any difference?
There is no bigger difference with the male and female, sir. Only the age differs from the more than 50 years and less than 50 years, only the patients are more anxious with the shorter dialysis, duration of dialysis.
Okay. So what is the reason you think? I mean, people on long duration of dialysis have more anxiety. People have more age group has more anxiety. What could be the reason you feel?
I think the reason will be in the lesser age group, the patients will be in the middle age. They will when they have the CKD, they tend to be more anxious and depression than the older patients. Sir.
Okay, thank you, Tiffy. Nice presentation.
Now you can have a second presenter. Sudhir, you can introduce.
Bhargavi, can you please start your presentation?
Yes, sir. I'm sharing my screen. Whether you can view my slides, sir?
Yes, please go ahead.
Okay, sir. Thank you for the opportunity, sir. Here today, we are going to discuss about importance of quality indicators in dialysis unit. And it's me, Bhargavi, who is working as a lead coordinator in dialysis unit at Manipal Hospital, Bangalore. And they are the team members who helped us in putting this paper forward. And why we need quality indicators in place in a dialysis unit especially. These quality indicators can be used as an important tool for the process of quality improvement mainly for the process of quality improvement. These quality indicators has to be established in dialysis unit, and this study is being done for that purpose, to analyze which are the quality indicators we were able to achieve and the list of quality indicators where we are not able to achieve, to identify the indicators where we were not able to achieve, and to ascertain any center-specific intervention is required to improve our results further. The study design is a single center cross-sectional study. The study was conducted in a tertiary care center, Manipal Hospitals, Bangalore. And this we usually do quarterly basis. So this study is done from April 2021 to June 2021. A total of 280 patients who are on maintenance hemodialysis for more than 1 month are included in the study. Were not initiated recently, but they are more than 1 month on MHD, currently who are on maintenance hemodialysis are included in the study. Minimum 6 quality indicators. These are the 6 minimum quality indicators which has to be maintained in every individual dialysis setup, which is really, really mandatory for providing a good quality dialysis to a patient. Coming to the first one, that is water quality, we do monthly samples for microbial count and endotoxin count. It is not just one sample, it depends on the unit size. If the unit is really big, we may have to require, we may require many samples which has to be sent for microbial growth. And then endotoxin samples, we make sure every machine is covered at least once in a year for endotoxin count or for dialysis fluid endotoxin analysis. And then coming to temporary access infection rate, especially temporary access, because the temporary access, which doesn't have cuff, is a major cause for infection. So we apply an infection rate formula, and then we assess our department temporary access infection rate. We do monitor dialysis adequacy by URR and KTYV by taking pre and post burn samples before and after dialysis. And then we monitor anemic status in dialysis patients by checking their hemoglobin levels, and then mineral bone disease status by checking their serum calcium and phosphorus, and then nutritional status by checking the serum albumin levels. And why we have shared this slide is this is how we capture the data. For an example, we have 280 patients. I've just displayed here, for example, 3 patients, X, Y, Z. For the month of April, May, June, some patients may do every month. Some patients may not be affordable to do every month. So they do once in 2 months or once in 3 months. So all the patients, 3 months blood reports are being captured, and we take an average of all the 3 months report, and that is being highlighted in yellow. This is in Excel sheet. And again, we filter all these yellow colored average values into the next Excel sheet. And again, we take an average of.
Internet is not stable. We're not able to hear you.
You're able to hear me now, sir?
Yes, yes, please.
Yes, you can go.
Yes, sir. We again take average of all the average values of each patient. So these are the average values of all the patients, and then again the last average value of together of the whole unit, sir. And then these are the number of tests done. For example, 282 patients, all 282 patients have done hemoglobin tests, and there are a number of patients who have done calcium and phosphorus, and then these are the number of patients who have done albumin, URR, and KTYV. And we are analyzing number of values which are falling as per the indicator, and then the number of values less than the normal range, and then the number of values more than the normal range. How do we calculate in Excel sheet is we apply COUNTIFS formula. We apply equal to COUNTIFS formula on the Excel sheet, and then we select the cells from which cell to which cell the number of reports which are entered on the Excel sheet. All the cells are selected, and we give the greater than criteria and then the lesser than criteria, and we apply this formula to calculate whether the patients are falling as per indicator, less than indicator, or more than indicator. Coming to water quality, there are a few things which has to be checked when it comes to water quality. Routine disinfection has to be done on monthly basis. And then we are, as I told, we are sending monthly samples for endotoxin count and microbial count. The sample has to be sent before disinfection. And early once we do send chemical analysis for complete chemical analysis for RO water, what we get as a product, that will be done once in a year. And we do check whether they are falling in the normal range as per AMI or ISO guidelines. These are the acceptable level. If we are doing standard hemodialysis, the acceptable level for microbial count is less than 100 CFU. Acceptable level for endotoxin count is 0.25. And if we are using ultra pure water, in case of we are doing online HDF, the standards require are ultra pure water. The microbial count should be less than 0.1 CFU and endotoxin count should be less than 0.03 EU per ml. As per our unit results, we have 100% compliance to these set standards. And then coming to dialysis adequacy, we are monitoring URR, urea reduction rate, and then KT by V, which is actually 1.4 for single pool KT by V because there will be a rebound post dialysis. So equilibrated KT by V, we are targeting for 1.2. If you're targeting equilibrated KT by V, 1.2 single
pool. Bhargavi, we'll have to conclude. Your time is up.
Yes, sir. These are the results. URR, it is 90% we have achieved. KT by V, 99% we have achieved. And the infection rate formula we have applied. And the infection rate is just 1.2% what we have achieved. Albumin, we have achieved almost 86%. And then hemoglobin, we have achieved 77%. Calcium and phosphorus was quite challenging for us. Phosphorus, we were not able to achieve because there are quite challenges in coming to the phosphorus level. This is the summary of our results. Where we are lacking is phosphorus, 56% only we were able to achieve. These are the indicators, these are the average values what we have got. And we are lacking in the number of tests done because patients are not affordable to do the pre-burn and post-burn sampling. And then we are lacking in phosphorus. So our corrective measures were, when it comes to hypophosphatemia, phosphate dialysate bath on dialysis we are planning, and then dietary counseling. When it comes to hyperphosphatemia, we are planning to review medications, dietary counseling for better phosphorus control, and to increase the duration of dialysis. When patients are not affordable for pre and post burn sampling, we are planning to do online clearance monitoring option, which is available with us. At least once in a month, we are planning to do online clearance monitoring. The conclusion of the study is, unless we have some quality indicators in place and we keep monitoring, we will not be able to identify where we are really lacking and how to do some interventional steps to improve these results. Ultimately, in ESRD patients, optimization of these dialysis quality monitoring is really required because this provides good quality of life to patients and ultimately resulting in better patient survival rate. Thanks for the teamwork. It's not a single man who is behind this presentation. We have a person who is sitting behind and entering all the data of 280 patients in an Excel sheet who's working.
Bhargavi, please conclude. Please conclude. Your time is up.
Yes, sir. Thank you for the opportunity.
You can have a short question.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please. Hello.
Yes, sir, please, if you have any question, otherwise we'll go to the next candidate, please.
Okay. One question for you, Bhargavi. While you do microbial study, what method you are using for a plate count for a CFU? Which media do you use for a CFU? Microbial count.
Yes, sir, it's a chocolate agar what they're using.
Okay.
I think we are just finding out whether the results are within the normal range. We make sure we coordinate with the microbiology team and we send around 8 to 9 samples every month. We make sure all are falling within the acceptable limits.
And you said that you were not able to achieve a phosphate level. What was the reason behind that?
Reason behind is phosphorus diet, high phosphorus diet we found. And then the one more reason is in case if we are extending the duration of dialysis hours and if we use high flux dialyzer, I think we will be able to achieve a high phosphorus thing.
Does that any correlation with the frequency of dialysis?
No, sir. No, sir. We haven't checked on frequency of dialysis. Almost 90% of our patients are thrice weekly dialysis, sir.
Okay. And okay. Thank you very much.
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
We can go to next presenter.
Yes, you can.
Yes, sir.
Please start.
Yeah, please start.
Hello, good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Shall I share my screen?
Please.
So, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Ms. Shreya Patange, so tutor at MGM School of Biomedical Sciences, Aurangabad, and I'm here to present today a topic on the use of hemodialysis procedure in case of COVID-19 infection when that patient will be going into a complication of AKI. So, here is my presentation. The aim of my study was to assess the use of hemodialysis in patients infected with COVID-19 infection along with the complications of AKI. And the another one was to check whether there is any significant improvement in the patients. So basically, as we all know what was COVID-19, so I won't make you bore in getting deep into the topic. It's just that it is a contagious disease caused by severe acute respiratory syndrome, SARS-CoV-2 virus. And these were the classification of symptoms like mild, moderate, and severe. So we can see here in severe symptoms, there is a point written as multi-organ dysfunction. So it is being depicting that whenever the virus is infecting a person, so that person can go in future into this condition of multi-organ dysfunction, where we can comes into the picture of kidney failure or as well. So this is the pathophysiology actually, like how the COVID-19 infection affected kidneys and it resulted into AKI. So there can be three ways, like one can be the cytokine storm, other one can be a pneumonia to the patient, which will lead to ARDS, that is acute respiratory distress syndrome, and the third one can be the hypercoagulability. So in this pathophysiology, it tells us like how the coronavirus, it was getting infected towards the kidney cells as well. The material and methodology for my presentation. Study design, this study was basically a cross-sectional observational study, and the data collection was done, was the primary data. I collected it from the MRD department of our hospital, and it was a convenient sampling method. So here is the pro forma chart based on which I collected my data. Our doctors and nephrologists in the dialysis unit at Aurangabad, everyone helped me a lot in preparing this pro forma chart and also filling it. So it depicts all the demographic data, then the basic information which were vital for the study and the lab investigations of the patient. So coming to the observation part, this is the demographic profile of the patient. Male was 69 and female was 19. Total patients I got the data was for 88 patients. These were the symptoms among which cough was the most common symptoms. Then the day of indications of the symptoms of the patient, like from second to fifth day, the patients experienced more severe indications. Then comorbidities in the patients were already present, like diabetes mellitus, hypertension, and coronary artery diseases. So the status of edema is here. The sensorium condition, many of the patients were alert in sensorium, but there was decrease in SpO2 level as well. So most of the patients required invasive ventilator mode. And these were the medications commonly given. Steroids include MPS, hydrocortisone, dexa. Then heparin was given, then antiplatelets. This is the chart depicting the patients. Remdesivir and favipravir injections were given. Among 51 patients, remdesivir was given, and in 6 patients, favipravir. So these were the lab indications. These depict actually the minimal range of observation found in total 88 patients and the maximum level of observations. The indications were these common, AKI due to ARDS, septic shock, then MODS, then metabolic acidosis or uremic encephalopathy. Number of sessions were frequently was given to the patient was 2 sessions of HD. Then these were the results of my study. Actually, like 34% of the patients survived only out of 88. And I know this is a very poor number, but the survival rate was very less. So this depicts that the patient needs more proper treatment as well as the comorbidities. Like as we discussed earlier, the patients had diabetes mellitus, then hypertension and coronary artery diseases. These comorbidities added more like to going towards the degradation of the condition of the patient. Also the response of patient towards the treatment, like we also calculated the SpO2 levels. But due to the short duration of time and the limit for the presentation, I was not able to put all the data. But in my proforma chart, I collected everything, right from SpO2 level. I mentioned as the ventilator status, like on admission, most of the patients came on invasive ventilation. Actually, we never do like this. We starting the patient ko invasive ventilation pe nahi lete. But due to the condition of the patient and the comorbidities which were pre-existing, it was done according to my data collection. The response of the patient to the treatment was also not that very good many times. Then the severity of infection was increased more and more. And the number of days of indications which we saw, like 2nd to 5th day, between these days, patient experienced more problems. And they actually there was delay many times as according to my observation from that data, there was a delay from patient side while coming to the hospital as well. As we all know that during the COVID condition, many people were scared to come to hospital. So that can be one of the reasons actually. So coming to the future prospects, now as we concluded, the survival rate was very less when the patient was taken on hemodialysis procedure to recover from this COVID-19 infection and the complication of AKI especially. So we can also think of going on different procedures like SLED or continuous hemodialysis or like CRRT procedures as well. So that's it, sir. This was my study. And the main motto behind this study was to check whether the patient really benefits from this hemodialysis procedure when he's actually having COVID-19 infection and going into the complication of AKI. Thank you, sir.
Judge is requesting you to ask some questions.
Yeah, it was a nice presentation. One thing I would like to know is that how many of patients, that is among the 88 patients, how many of them died due to AKI or how many of them died due to severe COVID? Incidentally, AKI was there in them. Because based on that information only, you can conclude whether the patients require a different mode of dialysis.
Okay, so basically this study was focused more on how many patients died due to AKI. So this was the result, like these out among these 88 patients, 34% patients they died due to AKI complications in COVID-19 infection. Not only because of COVID-19.
So because in most of the studies on AKI in COVID, they died due to the severity of the disease rather than AKI per se. Distinguish this, more data are required. This is failure and other factors and so on. Then only we can decide whether continuous therapy or acute peritoneal dialysis would have helped and all that. That question cannot be answered in these observations. Anyhow, thank you for the good study.
Thank you so much.
Thank you,
Shreya, for your